certain rules of the game, we need certain norms. These norms are not there. Your privacy, your rights to a place without hate speech, your right to know what's going on the social platforms, why algorithms show you the information that you see on YouTube and other platforms, you don't have that. You don't have access for researchers to data that they need to establish the facts, how platforms behave. We don't have common standards, we don't know, have common definitions, we don't have accountability for social platforms. So we are absolutely vulnerable. When I say we, I mean Latvia and the European Union in general, which will be the actual regulatory framework, and the Western democracies in general. And in terms of recipients, it's a much more interesting picture, I think. We are somewhat resilient as a society because of the high awareness. We know that other countries are working on harming us, which is a very important thing to know, so there is some general understanding of the issue in the society. It's a good start. Second, why we are somewhat resilient, we have free media. We are number 24 on the world media freedom list. It's not perfect, we know that. You know, those who live in Latvia, how much we debate the role of media in the society, but it's, again, not the worst place to be. Free media are a precondition for dealing with disinformation, period. Now, the plus point that I wanted to make is following. We know from childhood that you can lie to all of the people for some time, you can deceive some people all of the time, but then we say, sooner or later, the lies become apparent. Now, the problem today for us is that you can actually lie to a big enough share of people for a long enough time to undermine your democracy. And on this, in this sense, we are extremely vulnerable as democracies today. Thank you.
So both Sebastian and Viktor, you touched upon Russia, social media, as basically making us vulnerable and threats toward democracy and what people think. But Philip, so from your perspective, from media, you work in Delphi, and you've actually seen how different interesting stories spread across Latvia. What's your take on this? So what's the biggest threat or vulnerability that we have from media perspective?
I would say that Latvian media sphere is not the strongest at the point. And of course, the 24th place is not the best, not the worst place where to be. But it's not a very good place also, because right now we have a quite big also political influence over the media. Also, the oligarchs is still here, and the corners of the free media, they are quite hard to find. In true, we have few players. We have public media. We have Delphi, TVNet news agency, Leta, and also this All Baltic Media. This is the center of the free media what we have right now. Of course, we have Periferia right there and other media outlets, but the core is just a few players. And that's why there are several questions how to stay safe, how to improve, and how to ensure that in case we can be protected. And when I say be protected, I think that if one media comes in some financial troubles, that what solutions it has and what can be done there. And if we look from the media perspective, then we have to think about this, not only about the Russian propaganda, but about the internal economy of media sphere. And right now it's not in the best place. And that's why, for example, Delphi, as media, what I represent, we are talking about some steps that could be taken. Well, one could be this regulation of social networks. But when we are talking about this social regulation of social networks, we are talking about digital attacks, what I believe all of you have heard before right now. Because if we look at, for example, the market, and an advertisement market per year is approximately 80 million euros, then the take what social network giants, as also Google and Amazon takes, is bigger than that. So that is one more risk what just stays behind us. Not in true, not behind, it's in front, and we have to deal with this, and that's where we need, for example, state help. And if, of course, in a liberal democracy, it's not the usual place where media says that that it needs state support and help, but right now we are in that position when we need it, and we need different support programs and also help in this policy of how to defend ourselves against big technology companies.
And then this kind of goes through these two schools. So one is that there's an external threat, you know, Russia's amazing fringe groups and alt-right, they are having these cool memes and they know what works of media. The other perspective is that we are vulnerable ourselves, and just touching upon what you said, essentially, well, Latvia also said that we don't need to tax Facebook and big corporations in Brussels 2 weeks ago, I think. So Latvia, one of the 14 or whatever states who said that we don't need that. So my question, yeah, you want to? No, but so my question is, so basically, what we need to do to address our vulnerabilities, what we can do more, tax more, essentially, well, Facebook, Google, who are big advertisers, and invest this money in local media to strengthen them, or what are the solutions to potential problems that we have here?
If you go around the European Union and look what are the main topics in journalism conferences, you can almost always find three topics, and they will be there. And the one of them are trust. The second is how to deal with the content in era of social networks. And the third is diversification of business models. And right now, what media can do and what media has to do is to work with those different business models, because it's clear that right now the advertisement segment will stay. And when we are talking about this business, we are talking also about the possibilities, how can we assure that our Latvians and Latvian citizens and all Latvian people will get quality information here. We need safe business models, and for that we need to improve our business models. Right now, that's the biggest challenge for, in my opinion, for Latvian media.
But I think the media everywhere struggles with this, how to essentially make money. If you can make money much better with memes.
Of course, but in Latvian case, we have to remember that we have extremely small market. And when we have such small market, then there comes this case that we need state support. And that's the fact from my side.
And what's the perspective of the state? Because you're playing the role of the state in the discussion, sorry.
I'd rather not represent the state and the government in general here. It's too much of a job for me, I guess. But I, first of all, agree that quality of media is an extremely important thing. And in one way or another, the society, the citizens have to invest. So one important thing to do is to convince our citizens that it is in their interest to invest through taxes or in other ways as private individuals in the availability of quality media content. That's a very important discussion. I will rather not touch. I'd rather not touch on the digital tax. We know it's a very interesting issue, quite discussed now. But there is another area that where actually important things are going on now, and I want to draw your attention to that. You know that almost exactly a year ago, the Code of Practice on Disinformation was signed. By the major social platforms and tech companies with the assistance of the EU. As such, it was a huge step forward. That was the first time the EU and the big players recognized that there is a challenge. So that's the good part. The problematic part is, of course, that this code, by and large, I would venture to say, has not worked as intended. So we are going to have some very intense discussions in the months to come about how to create norms of behavior on social platforms. My hunch is that this is going to be a European debate, so not just individual member states creating their own rules. It is not going to be about regulating content. So forbidding, criminalizing disinformation generally, this is not what this is going to be about. It is going to be, as was already mentioned here, about creating standards of behavior, accountability, transparency on what the social platforms do. So we are going to have streetlights. Just like we got cars and then we got streetlights, because without streetlights, using your freedom to move in a car led to a mess. Now, this is all well, and it's quite important. This is a practical job, so to say, for the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, for others. How do we address the issue of creating certain norms, maybe regulation? But there is a larger problem to address here, and I don't have a solution to that. The problem today is that people invest their trust in different places. They used to invest their trust in classic newspapers and television channels, just like they used to invest their trust in regular politicians. And what we see today is people finding other places to go for information, ideas, emotions, and also for things that they want to believe in. That's a big challenge, but I don't know.
I think this analogy with cars is very good. Because if you look at history, initially, no rules, no seat belts, no streetlights, as you said. And now, after 100 years, we've come earlier than 100 years, but still we came to an agreement how this whole system of infraction, well, you know, streets works. The same with online. So we've had it for the last 30 years. It's not a lot. It's something new that humanity has never seen before. So trust, standards, regulations, rules. So what's your take on this? What to do? How to fight or regulate this information online?
No, and we've been pushing for quite some time with trying to understand how to regulate not content but the processes surrounding social media companies to make sure that that we create a transparent market, which I actually think will help the social media companies as well. Because today there's nothing to incentivize or even standardize investment against this information on the platforms. Whoever invests the least makes the largest amounts of profit. So even if you're a social media platform that would like to put money down to spend on this, you're not going to be rewarded by your investors for doing this, because it's not a legal requirement, it's not a regulatory requirement, and it doesn't necessarily translate into money for you. While, for an example, if you have a restaurant that has inspections by the local authorities from time to time, you don't want to get blacklisted for having rats in the kitchen. So unless we have this sort of transparency, we're not going to incentivize social media companies to do something about it. But, and I think that's a very good point, this is only a part of the problem. The other part of the problem is that people... we have new political parties that have, and their voters usually align with other sorts of trust authorities in society, often media media stations or media platforms that don't sign up to the code of contact, code of practice, not the social media code of practice, but those rules that all media have adhered to for such a long time. So what do we end up with? Well, we end up with a divided society where part invest their trust in sites we have little transparency in. They peddle in other forms of news online. And to deal with that issue, regulation of social media is not going to be enough. It's going to help with artificial inflation. It's going to help with lack of transparency in who says what. We might deal with the issue of foreign interference to a larger extent. But the larger issue of how do we create a online environment that is conducive to good, genuine intellectual discussions, That will continue to be a discussion. And it's back to where we begin, to where we started a little bit. In the very early in Sweden, when we started having newspapers, all of them would publish names on perpetrators, would have these lengthy statements from trials. They would smear certain groups because these sold magazines. In the end, of course, this created a lot of social turmoil, and the newspapers decided, oh, we should have a common code of practice. We should have a board where, you know, people, if they get hurt, can come and get grievances. That there should be a way to have alternative voices published in the newspapers. And then comes the internet, and then comes sites that don't adhere to these practices, and we end up again with the need for new traffic lights. And how to get this for the alternative media space, I think that will be an even larger challenge. Because with the social media platforms, at least, there's companies that are responsible that we can regulate. How do we regulate the myriad of fringe sites? And if you take my own country in Sweden, these are not sites that are small. Some of them are they are equivalent to the largest regional newspapers, and they attract a substantial followership. And but they do not adhere to normal journalistic practices.
And the next problem is, even if you try to close them down, they just move the country far away and put their servers and webpage somewhere else that you can't touch. It doesn't really solve the issue.
No, it doesn't. And of course, trying to strengthen democracy, the solution won't be to shut down sites or to get them to move away, because it's not going to work. It's going to stifle ourselves. And so we need to find a way where we could adhere to a common system that involves these new actors, because hopefully it will be to their benefit as well. The big question, I think, is how long will these fringe movements be financially viable? Because it's interesting, because all the established news sites, they struggle a lot with financial side of news. While many of the populist news sites, they don't seem to have any problem with financial with the financial aspects of it. Is it because of who finances them, or because they have a different business model? And how do we then regulate the business models? That is a different challenge.
Yeah, I could just add that in Latvia we have experienced that the shutting down example just doesn't work. We saw that with the Sputnik, and the other case is that it is possible to be profitable. And for example, Delphi is one of the cases. For the last, since the crisis, we every year we have profit. We have 1 year, I think, where we can't find profit, and also there is some explanation with some asset movements, not because some business downfall. And I would say that it is possible in Latvia also for to be this successful media outlet with profit and with quality content. That's one of the points you both said about trust, and of course we see that in Latvia mostly we trust in church, I think, in army, police, and of course also television and radio. But also for the last 6 or 5 years, if I look to the Delphi content and which articles are the most read, then mostly before 6-7 years we would find in the top some entertainment section or sports, or mostly entertainment. Right now, all the most read articles are national and business news. So we can turn our content in such a way that audience is interested. So it's just a question of do we have this setup in media and mindset to do that.
Speaking of audience, I'm going to give possibility to ask questions in a minute, because I wanted just to follow up on this. So very often this gets very theoretical. You know, it's like social media company somewhere out there, Russia somewhere out there. My question is, so what has been done? What are you doing to help individual societies? Because I know in Delphi there were a couple of campaigns. As a researcher, what are you trying to do and convey to increase resilience of societies, and what has Latvian states been doing to increase awareness or resilience?
I mean, from our side, it's been primarily of trying to measure the effects of things. When we take closing down media, for example, we did an interesting research piece, I I think last year on what happened in the Ukraine when they banned access to their contacte. And what we could see was that it didn't limit people's access to VK. People would just use VPNs. What happened instead was that the people that were on VK were engaged in even harsher and even more disruptive engagement, because all the moderate and sane voices disappeared because they lost the energy to use a VPN to get into VK. So it turns out that by banning VK in the Ukraine, we created an even more poisonous environment. And so studying these issues, providing that insight will, of course, in the end, hopefully allow politicians to formulate opinions that they can then advocate for, so that voters can choose politicians after which kind of opinions they advocate for. That hasn't happened yet. So far, when we've had a discussion on what to do about the internet, it's been a lot of politicians didn't even know what the internet was 10 years ago, and that has changed because of insight. And I also think we need to do these kind of experiments that we've been doing to try to test social media companies, to try to understand what is actually happening, what is actually going on, because we're not getting that insight now. I don't know why we have so much trust in social media companies, but many of the figures that come from these companies, we tend to instinctively believe in a way we would never believe if it came from a bank or a chemical company. Simple facts, like Facebook saying that they have employed 30,000 moderators. They're like, ooh, 30,000 moderators, that's great. It's like, yeah, has anyone seen the list of people they employ? Has anyone know that they actually got these people? Are they fully employed? Are they partially contractors in Indonesia? But if a chemical company said, no, we've reduced emissions by 90%, we would be like, yeah, whatever, let's send an independent auditor there and measure that. So we put a lot of trust in these companies, undeserved trust, and we need to get around that and start realizing that we need to see the facts so that we can regulate with intelligence.
But from one side, we are talking about this, that we could try to regulate, but then maybe we forget that behind Facebook or Amazon, there stands extremely protective state policy right now, and we would get a lot of pushbacks. And of course, right now France is dealing with it, and it could also become a problem of the Eastern European region also. So do we know all the risks? What could come back?
No, and I think this is super interesting. Regulation, especially, where do we regulate? Because Facebook is everywhere, but are we saying that autocratic states should regulate the online environment? Well, probably not. We wouldn't think that was a good idea, because it wouldn't be democratic regulation of these platforms, it would be autocratic regulation, which means that we will need different kinds of regulation for a common online space, and that is very difficult. And these powerful interests behind these companies, it's funny because some of them are you and me. My pension funds in Sweden is partially invested into Facebook, which means that the Swedish state pension funds has an interest in keeping up the value of Facebook, and here and I'm sitting saying that, maybe we don't really know how we value these companies because it's based on the number of users, and they don't know that. So we have within the same state as well different opinions and different motivations. So that alone is a challenge, I think.
Getting back to the question, so what are essentially Minister of Foreign Affairs or Latvian government doing to increase resilience, fight essentially disinformation? And Philip, what's Delphi been doing in this regard?
That would require a very long answer that we don't have time for. So, no, seriously, I think the government has recognized the problem. That's one big step forward. It's not in every country, but in Latvia at least, the government in a broader sense and the society have recognized that we're dealing with an issue that is about the survival of our democracy as such. Another thing that is important that the Latvian government has not done, and it's extremely important and positive, it is not trying to address disinformation with censorship. Again, we know there are certain countries that are trying out this approach. We haven't done so. I think it's for the good. So we're not trying to sanitize the information environment, we're trying to immunize citizens to disinformation. On a practical level, if you look at the recently published National Security Concept, it lists disinformation as one of the major challenges to this country's security. And number one measure that this document proposes is strengthening media. Now, I guess Philips and other media professionals will have a lot to say about how much and how successfully the government has worked to strengthen the media environment in Latvia, but at least there is a recognition of the fact that this is what we need to do. Other things that have been in progress is improving the government communications capacity. Sometimes people call it Stratcom. I don't know, after having led a unit that wasn't Stratcom, I still don't know what Stratcom exactly means. But in terms of government communications, the ability of government to communicate timely and clearly to the citizens, it's very practical work. It's not politically controversial, but there is a lot of efforts now underway to make sure that we actually can do that on everyday basis, also in a crisis situation. We will have to get better at monitoring and analyzing what's going on in the information environment. It is somewhat easy today, or relatively easy today, to know what's on television, what's in the newspapers, what's on radio, what's on social platforms. That's still a challenge, and we come back to the role of the social platforms that have done a lot recently to make it more difficult for us to understand what's going on, what kinds of narratives, what kinds of movements, also inauthentic behavior is present there. But we have to basically get better at that, and we have to put pressure on the social platforms to be more responsible. So this is what we are doing, this is what I'm doing in my daily work. I talk to other countries, I talk to counterparts in Brussels, raising this issue. So that's what we do. And of course, media literacy has been mentioned here, I presume, a lot of time. Just a word of caution, at least from my perspective, it's an important thing. It's as necessary as dental hygiene, but it's not going to save you from a boxing punch. We need it, but let's not hope that media literacy will solve the issue. It will not. Thank you.
Philip?
I could say that we are doing right now three things. The first one would be providing quality content, and that's the main task what do we have. The second would be that we have a social network team, five people in a Delphi team, and they are on an everyday basis. Their main task is not just spread our content on Facebook or on TikTok or whatever where, but also to monitor what happens there. And that means that also, for example, Facebook, several times we have had a conversation with them. We have gone to Ireland, for example, to the Google headquarters in Europe. Also, not Google, but Facebook, yeah, of course. And also we have made some conversations in Riga with Facebook guys here. And we are trying to understand everything what they are doing. And we are, when they do something, when they change anything, then we do the same immediately. And that's how we try to keep hand on pulse what's happening there. And the third thing would be that I would say similar as my colleague from state institution, sorry for that, but that media literacy programs. We are trying to participate in every media literacy program where it's possible. Our journalists participates there. And we are also organizing by ourselves, and that's the one of the things that Clinton Watchmill said before here, that we need long-term programs, and we understand that also, and in Delphi philosophy, we think that we need to do it for several years, just straight, not just for a few months. So that would be from Delphi side.
We had something.
Yes. Just because I forgot, which is a huge, huge mistake on my part, because when you ask what the Ministry of Foreign Affairs has done, there is one thing that we have been doing for almost 5 years now, and I want to mention it. We insisted in Brussels that the EU, the External Action Service, starts fighting back on Russian disinformation narrative. So in 2015, the EU created the EU East Stratcom Task Force. The task force does several things, does positive communications in the Eastern Partnership countries, but it also works on exposing Russian disinformation. It runs website and social media under the brand EU versus disinformation. And there you find a lot of interesting facts about what the Russian propaganda machine is doing and why what these Russian propaganda outlets are saying is not actually true. Now, our contribution to this is we have been seconding for the, from our budget an expert, a national expert to this team, because it's more than half of it, I think, national contributions through national seconded experts. So this is our contribution in hard currency. Thank you.
Okay, quick round of questions. So there's one. Anyone else?
Good evening. My name is Udi Salta. I'm a student of this faculty. And I have a question to Mr. Lostkorkis. Sometimes I save some screenshots of things that ring the alarm bells in my head. And I have one screenshot from 4th of November, which was 2 days before the doctors' protest regarding the wages. And it comes from the site that you represent. I will quote the title. It says, title of a news article, some doctor in Latvia earns 39,000 euros per month. How would you comment the existence of such an article in such context 2 days before the doctors' protest? And what were the editorial choices behind this kind of article?
Anything else? Okay, Philip, the floor is yours.
Okay, yeah, that current news item for that day came from news agency Letter, and for that day it was one of the most important news, because when we talk about policy around how to talk, even talk about this question about salaries of doctors, it's important to see all the facts. And that one was, at that current day, that one was the one of the important ones. Why? In true, that because it was published in Letter and we have contracts with them. Approximately 20% every day of the content what we have comes from news agency Letter, and we trust them as one of the most important media outlets in Latvia. We do not have any doubts about the quality of that or the reasons behind that. I saw the discussion afterwards that it could be the could be manipulated to somehow impact decision making about process of salaries of doctors in that week. I don't believe that. No, of course not, because GDPR, maybe you have heard about that. For the last year, we have strict rules about how we can report about current people, about and what personal data we can say. And of course, we knew what person that was, but we can't, for example, to say his name or her name. It would be important news 2 days after, or 1 week after, or 1 year after.
I think we can get into this, because this is a very specific question. If you want, you can.
I'll jump in, because I think this is an interesting example of what I hope we would have in the end. I mean, we have a media representative, we have someone who's concerned with a specific article, of which I have no idea what was going on. But, you know, being able to hold someone to account from that news outlet is a very good thing. And I'm hoping that there is a way where, if you were wrong, that you could seek grievances with a council that would force you to publish a correction if it was wrong.
And we can also see who funds and owns your news organization, I hope, not knowing the specifics. While we have so many outlets out there who we don't know who they own, if we are depressed with what they're doing, we cannot hold them to account. So the question I would want to strive for is, how do we reach this sort of situation in the media environment as a whole? And you know, you would be able to issue a correction, but a bigger question, which I think is very interesting, but also very theoretically difficult, is what do we do on social media when we've had something, it's trended, it's had its impact? In this case, as you mentioned before, demonstration. How do we issue corrections in a timely way so that it undoes the impact of the faulty information or the manipulative information?
Just in this case, it wasn't manipulated information or wrong information. No. That was a fact with sources. Just we were not able to reveal this person's name.
Sorry, I had no idea about the specific case. I'm saying, had it been, or would it be proved to be, how would you go about issuing?
For example, before 2 weeks, Delphi made mistake. I think before 2 weeks, there was a fire in a city Riga, in one flat, and we reported that the fire was in one popular pub. Some type of pub, Kanyepes Culture Center, in that sense. And that information was wrong, because that was one house right next to that pub. And right now, if you would Google that news item, you would find that in last line, there would be the correction that we reported incorrectly, and that mistake was corrected. That we are not doing that always. But we are trying to identify in which way we could escape this manipulating the reader, because maybe that in start one reader read this article and thought, oh, Kanyepes Culture Center was on fire. After 2 hours or 3 hours, he or she reads again, and now it's another house next to, and he thinks maybe he's crazy or whatever, or we are trying to change the content without any consequences. In such cases, we are trying to take responsibility like that.
And I think this is one of the things we're struggling with on. I mean, traditionally, if there was a magazine, you would read the magazine, you would complain, next issue there would be a correction somewhere under corrections. If we take the case of Russians interfering in Africa, we know that in Cameroon, for an example, local actors were employed to write bogus articles. Well, we know Facebook claims that this happens. Well, of course, there is nobody who issues corrections to these Cameroonians who would have read articles written by a foreign state to deceive them. Instead, there is a report written and published by Stanford University, and the likelihood that those Cameroonians read that report is not very high. So it's interesting. How do we, in the fast-paced environment, in the modern age, issue corrections so that they are timely and reach the people who read the article in the first place?
Yeah, Victor, sure.
Yeah. Well, one of the ways to derail discussion on a particular subject, and I'm not referring particularly to what you said. One of the ways to derail discussion is to expand the topic or to expand the definitions in a way that make the discussion meaningless. It's very easy to do with disinformation. Without taking a position in the discussion between you two guys, honestly, I don't think this is about disinformation. The media may be sloppy. They may be lazy journalists who don't check their facts. But when we say disinformation, we refer to something quite different. We refer to strategic attempts to manipulate with our minds by introducing falsehoods, factual falsehoods, narrative falsehoods, emotional identity elements in that with a specific purpose. You could theoretically argue that by giving you wrong data on the salaries of the media organization wanted to achieve a specific goal. And there are indeed certain media outlets in the world that do exactly that. You can say that there are some media who actually have disinformation at the core of their business model. But in many cases, we are talking about very imperfect media organizations. They're always imperfect. They can make everyone angry. But I don't think that what they do is disinformation. sloppy work sometimes, perhaps. Let's have a debate about that. Let's have a debate about quality of media and how the society should keep that quality in check. But this is not disinformation, with all respect.
You can. Yeah, sure.
Very interesting debate. I just would like to say that I think GDPR is not related to your approach. It doesn't have anything in common with what you're doing as a protection of sources in that sense, if I understand it correctly. GDPR is about something else. But my question is to Viktor Makaros. I have had discussion with some Latvians here for the last couple of hours and days, and what you said is very interesting, because you mentioned that actually Baltic states, or maybe Latvia itself, has initiated this Stratcom, you know, initiative and fighting, etc., on the Eastern Front. And first question would be, how would you assess that, evaluate success of this initiative after 5 years or something like that, you said? If it is possible to measure, because maybe it's not, it's difficult in social sciences, humanities, you know, this, it's, you know, sometimes difficult to relevant to come to a measure. But the second question related is whether, and I apologize, I don't want to be really rude or whatever, but just provocative, if you don't mind. What if your policies are contradictory? I mean, one ministry has this kind of policy and other ministry has different policies. And I mean, what this language, education in Russian language, which has strengthened, you know, this level or scope of education in Russian language. Because when you think it, as I am a foreigner here, so on the one hand, you are fighting in this front, you know, the conspiratory, etc., coming from Russia. But on the other hand, you are not really encouraging local Russians to integrate and to believe in your media, in your society, because it is against human basic feelings in nature. And if you understand what I'm saying, you know, it seems to me as a foreigner, it's totally different, opposing and negating policies of the same government, probably. Thank you.
The second is especially easy to answer.
Yeah, wonderful questions, thank you. On the first one, the scourge of project mentality sometimes is that they ask you to put quality indicators by which you will be assessed later. I don't know whether introducing, not quality, but quantity indicators. I don't think that quantitative indicators, for example, help you describe whether a marriage or a friendship is a success. So sometimes we can't do that. To come back to the specific example of the East Stratcom Task Force, I think it has been extremely effective because I know how much what they have been doing has resonated in the EU member states and also outside. They have provided a platform for journalists, for civil society, who want to talk about these issues, and they have a resource ready explaining what the Russian disinformation activity is about. In Latvia, perhaps there is very little novelty in what we hear from them, because we have been talking about this for a long time now. We know, we realize what the opponents are doing. In other EU member states, honestly, from the questions I get from colleagues in these countries, I can see that a conversation about what the Russian disinformation means, it's a very necessary conversation. So it's good that the East Stratcom Task Force are helping people get information about that. The fact that the EU has also created similar, slightly different, but similar Stratcom task forces for West Balkans and South, I think, is kind of proof that this is a useful thing. That being said, I don't think that the way forward is doing just more of the same thing. The task force is extremely important. We are fighting every day to make sure that they have sufficient funding, and the mandate is strong. They have been developing, they do more in terms of monitoring and analysis. It's very helpful. But this is not going to replace the things that have to be done in the member states by other actors. So yes, they are good, they are successful, but they're just one important element in a much broader puzzle. To come back to your second question again, it's a completely different topic. And now this comes from a perspective of someone who you referred to, the so-called Russian minority, or rather people from whom Russian is their first language. And I know a thing or two about integrating, not integrating, and how people feel. And I think you can have lots of discussions about the specific policies over the last 30 years. Those have been changing. So we need to be specific. I don't think that there is generally an unwelcoming attitude. I think that today, paradoxically, and this is to come back to the issue we have been discussing, there is still plenty of information and also quality media available in the Russian language. Delphi has a Russian site. LSMLV, which is a public service broadcaster, has a Russian version. Latvian radio runs a Russian service 24/7. LTV, the public service television broadcaster, has content in Russian. So I wouldn't say that the attitude is unwelcoming. And the policies that you refer to actually have the goal of helping the people for whom Latvian is not their first language to learn the language. And these policies are not put in place to somehow try and assimilate people and make them forget their first language. That's simply not what these reforms are about. And then you can discuss whether they are good at achieving that kind of balance. It's a completely different discussion. But the problem sometimes is that apart from wanting their information in the Russian language, many people want a specific kind of content. And again, people are different. There is no such thing as a Russian community here, because people are extremely diverse in terms of their linguistic repertoire, in terms of their political positions, their values, and so on and so on. Many people want a specific kind of media. They want some people, not the majority, but some people want a narrative in the media that is sympathetic to the Russian government. We can create a lot of quality content in the Russian language, but I don't think we're going to create content that is of that kind. So we need to find new ways to address different audiences within that bigger group. Thank you.
It's a shame we're out of time, because both questions, we could debate this for another hour or so. But the idea of this whole discussion was essentially to just outline where we stand. But also, it's not just about vulnerabilities. We also do quite a lot. There's much to do, but it's not the case. We're only on defense, we're only vulnerable. We're actually, in some occasions, quite good at defeating Russian propaganda, also fringe groups. We try to do quite a lot. And very often, there's this story that we're vulnerable, we're attacked, we're weak. I would rather disagree with this. We do quite a lot on this front. Let's give a round of applause to our speakers. And there's a coffee break outside, then let's get back in a couple of minutes. Thank you.